Welcome once again to another episode of Women on Fire. Dear beloved, make yourself comfortable. Sit comfortable before your television set and spend this next half an hour in the presence of the Lord. We are continuing today with a subject called baptism. We talk about baptism of water. We talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now we are going to talk about the baptism of the fire of suffering, also of martyrdom. So let us start now. Here it is, Courtney and Angeline and Nelly. We welcome you to be part of our little T section. Now, with the baptism of fire, we have many scriptural references where the Lord Jesus speaks of the fire by which, the baptism by which he would be baptized. Can you think of anything like?
There's here in the book of Luke 12:50, I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and how greatly and surely I am urged on, impelled, constrained, until it is accomplished. This is the words of the Lord.
Wow. The Lord Jesus himself knows that there is a baptism coming to him.
Yes.
He is compelled to it.
Yes.
So it's almost no longer he's in full control of it. He has allowed himself, and then he's entered into and being compelled to this baptism.
Yes.
What an amazing move of the Holy Spirit. So what is this baptism he's talking about?
It's the baptism of suffering, because that is what he wants to accomplish. Because that's what he accepted when the Father sent him to rescue us from the spirit of death, to reconcile us to the Father through that suffering.
That's right.
And because we were lost completely, destined to under the power of the darkness.
That's right.
So he loved us so much, and he, as you said, he was compelled and eager to accomplish that, what he promised.
That's right.
And he went through that, such a suffering that no one went through like he did.
Yeah.
So this is something that we will always remember and be grateful for what he did to us. He changed us all our life with that sacrifice.
That's right.
Oh, completely. We are new creatures, new species.
That's right.
Yes.
What a love. Yes. It's indescribable. It is not of this world. It is not the natural love.
No.
It's a supernatural love.
Yes.
For somebody to do that. But he experienced in his flesh all this. He knew he would. It's just an amazing thing. I can remember the scriptures where this lady came upon the Lord Jesus Christ. You remember that?
And the one who said, the one when he was carrying the cross?
No. This one, when this lady wanted her sons to sit on the right, on the left.
And the mother of John and James.
Yes, that's right. Do you know that?
Yes.
You say, I indeed baptize you in the water because of repentance. That's in Matthew 3:11. And that is because of your changing your mind for the better, heartily amending your ways with abhorrence of your past sins. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I.
That's right.
Right? And who sends,
yes,
I'm not worthy of or fit to take off or carry, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and the fire.
That's right. That's the words of John.
Yes.
the words of
that
John.
Fire is a purification, is that
yes.
the word?
Yes.
It's a purifying fire. It's purified.
Mm. Yes.
It's right. a different intensity again compared to water that is the Holy right. Spirit.
That's right.
And there's a different level of relationship and intimacy again with the Lord.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Well, I remember in the scriptures he says that to have the purest levels of gold, mm-hmm. the goldsmith submits the stone, the rock that they get from the mountains, seven times to intense fire.
Yes.
Intense fire, and so the rock melts,
mm-hmm.
and so does the gold.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens is the weight in between the gold and the rock is different, so all the debris goes yes. up to the top.
Yes,
and the goldsmith removes all the debris.
Mm-hmm.
And then the gold is a bit purer mm-hmm. and is allowed to cool off for a while.
Yeah.
Isn't that right?
Yes.
And then guess what? Fire again! And seven times purifies gold. So the Lord Jesus knows that he's going to go to an intense preparation, an intense suffering, the fires of suffering that will make him ready to the finals, to the culmination of his destiny, which is crucifixion.
Yes.
Likewise, we believers should not shy away from sufferings. We should not be binding and losing sufferings. Because suffering is essential.
Yes.
It's like the fire the goldsmith uses to purify. Now, tell me, you can be sincere to me. When things go nice and dandy, we all perfect Christians. Is that right or wrong?
Yeah, it's wrong.
Is it wrong?
Yes, because we have to suffer. That's what our destiny is, because Jesus suffered.
Okay.
Yeah.
But if we are having it really nice, we all look like perfectly nice, well-behaved, balanced believers. Is that right
yes.
or wrong?
Right.
I look at it as this way. In good times, if we are baptized, we have such a relationship with God, we know how to expand it, should I say, if I use the word right word, enlarge, there's enlargement mm-hmm. into the kingdom and the things of God. For those who are going through trial and tribulations or testing, there will be a time of, like to say, refining fire,
mm-hmm.
molding,
yes.
shedding,
yes.
debris, shave off.
That's right.
But what is good will remain.
That's right.
right. What is not good will go. Because the words say right. very clearly, the Lord will purify, will test, and build,
mm.
will correct, will chasten,
That's
hasten
right.
the child of God, the mm. children of
That's
God.
Right.
It's only a father with a loving heart will go all extent mm. to do it. But
yes.
because he knows mm. whatever the cause is, he will bring him back.
Yes.
If his heart is
that's
willing
right.
to come to
that's
me.
Right.
I think that's what the purification and fire is talking about
yes.
when it comes to suffering.
Mm.
So we do not, for Christians who go through all this, we do not need to despair because we know ultimately we
yes,
have an advocate
absolutely.
Up in heaven who never cease to intercede and has given us all these gifts within us.
Mm.
And as the body of Christ, we must unite together to work and move forward as one. Because
Amen.
The Lord... It's one.
Amen.
The Holy Trinity.
Amen, Connie.
Right? We're going to go across denomination, all cultural differences, and we'll come together.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
All right. And sometimes when we talk about sufferings, we kind of want to hide a little bit away, even of the conversations, because it gives us images of what we have might have gone through, that we did not enjoy. But at the end of it all, once we... let go of all the past, we are able to look at the past with thankful hearts because it makes us better people. And this is the the sufferings that Christ went, he did not go to be polished himself. No. It was his preparation. And in our cases, it's not so much as God taking the scum. However, when things go wrong, sometimes we surprise ourselves or other people by the reactions that we come up with. Something so hidden, but when the pressure is on, boop, shows up. And that's exactly what God wants these things to show up, wants us to make a way. You see Stella, or you see Courtney, you see Nelly, you see Angeline. This was hidden there. These are the hidden sins.
Yes.
So you see and you say, oh, I'm sorry, Lord. In your private time, you talk to God and you say, yeah, I didn't do what was right, or I didn't want this, or I didn't want that, or I fought you this way, or I resisted you that way. Whatever it is, when things don't go right, some cases, it shows up our weaknesses. Yes. It shows up the things we need change.
Yes.
Until we have been perfected. Then you know what? Waters pass by, and we're still rejoicing in the Lord.
Yeah.
Why? Because we're dead. Have you ever imagined somebody in a coffin and the fly comes? I never seen a dead person go, phew! Yeah? The troubles of this world are like that fly.
Yes.
No longer affect us.
No.
But suffering is a wonderful school of dying. It's a wonderful, yes. It's also humbling us,
yes.
You know. When the time of suffering comes, we cannot be all that cocky anymore.
No.
Can we?
No.
You know, things are, not. But God doesn't do this to point the finger at us, right?
No.
He preparing us to be that immaculate bride, that warrior bride, that doesn't crumble at the first problem. Now,
that's why the process that God takes us is so wonderful, you know.
Yes.
Like, he doesn't take you through baptism of fire from the start. He takes you through baptism of water, then Holy Spirit. So he builds you, strengthens you, and then after that you go through fire and suffering, by which time you would have more of Christ in us, that we are able to endure the suffering for the sake of Christ.
Yes.
Amazing.
And his ways is always the best, you know?
Yes.
Once the trusting comes. He doesn't think like we think.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why he says, my ways are better than yours, my thoughts are better than yours.
Yes.
So that makes you think. And whatever God puts you through, he's in control, so we must go through, you know, go along. And to our surprise at the end, it was for our benefit.
Always.
Praise God.
Always. So, you know the scriptures where God talks about the salt?
Yes.
And he says, you are the salt of the earth. And salt loses his flavor.
I think in Mark, it says, for everyone shall be salted with fire.
Yes.
Salt is good, beneficial, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how will you restore the saltness to it?
That's right.
Have salt within yourselves and be at peace and live in harmony with one another.
Amen.
So he's talking about the salt. You know, many times, you know, read this scripture and it didn't dawn on me, really, that, because sometimes you say, okay, I'm the salt, and you know, but how do you get salty? And how do you lose the saltiness?
Mm-hmm. Well, I have an idea.
You go for it.
Well, I've been asking the Lord, what does it mean? First of all, in the natural, the salt is something it preserves, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he, through his truth and his teaching, we are being preserved. And saltiness comes through our behavior, through our walk in the Lord, through our the habits we accomplish, you know, knowing the truth of God, and how humble we become, and how, as the Bible says, be humble and upright, and God will pour His secrets on you. All these things, you know. Mm-hmm. So when we change, accept it, you know, gradually the transformation is what saltiness comes. So we are ready to witness others. You know, in Colossians says that your conversation might be salted.
Salt.
Yeah,
yes.
Salted with fire, as it says. And so you are ready for any questions. Mm-hmm. So this is what we are going to be in the end times, children of God. Will be used by others, because they will see the saltiness and the light of God. It will show.
That's
it will
right.
reflect in our words, in our attitudes, and that's why I believe that saltiness is.
That's right. That's right.
Amen.
And also, as he says, everyone shall be salted by fire. Mm-hmm. Mm. Salted by fire. So it is the fire that actually make us salty. Mm-hmm. So how do we get the fire going? We were talking about the Holy Spirit. How do you get that fire strong all the time?
Mm-hmm. I was just
Jude 1:20, remember?
Yeah.
Mm. Jude 1:20, build yourself together in the most holy Ghost.
Praying in the Holy Spirit.
So praying in the Holy Spirit gets that fire going.
Yes.
The fire of the suffering, yes, as well. It's very important. We are talking about that fire. Mm. But we can lose the saltiness of the fire.
Mm. Stir yourself
if
up.
If we don't, that's right.
Yes. Stir yourself up.
So we must do that so we can stay salty. What does salty does?
Preserves.
It preserves. That's right. What else does it do on a dish?
Flavor.
Flavor.
Taste. Yes.
Yeah. We become flavorsome to the hearers and the beholders.
Yes.
We give flavor to the life. Yes. Mm. Of people around us, but that fire that is inside of us. And if people want to touch that fire that is in you, because it's tasty, you know, it's like a nice tasty meal, you have a taste, you want to eat it.
Yes.
Same thing, it draws the world onto the Lord, because it's the more of the Lord in us through that fire.
Yes.
Yeah. But Angelina has something to say.
Oh, something just came to me when you were speaking. No? Salt in the natural, when they produce salt, something is taken away from it, something is evaporated from it. Mm-hmm. And then the salt has to go through a process, a treatment, to make it into salt. Mm-hmm. Likewise, in the spiritual, something in us has to be taken away by God. Our flesh, and we must be willing to go through the process, the treatment, you know, in order to be made into the salt.
Hallelujah.
So we have to yield to the Holy Spirit to go through that treatment, the process.
Amen. Amen. Now, that's wonderful. Wow. Yes. You know, even just in the midst of us, the Lord is speaking and showing us wonderful things. I hope everybody's enjoying this. Now, in Luke 12, verse 49, Jesus spoke about some fire.
Mm.
Can I read it to you?
Yes, please.
He says, I have come to cast fire upon the earth.
All right.
And how I wish that it were already kindled. But for that fire to come upon the earth, what had to happen before? He spoke this while he was walking on earth as a human, man of God. And he says, I've come to bring a fire upon the earth. How I desire this already kindled. But he couldn't bring the fire while he was talking. What had to happen?
So I guess you have to stir up the gifts within us, pray in the most holy faith, again, tongues, and stir up, so to stir up, activate the gifts in us, and just,
That is correct.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, Jesus as a man of God in the earth is saying that he is going to throw fire upon the earth, but he's not able to do it then. He's looking forward to the time where he actually can do it. What I felt is the Lord is talking about the release of the Holy Spirit that would take place after the crucifixion.
Yeah, yes, yes.
Remember he said the apostles? Yes. He says, I'm going right now.
I'm going up.
But don't worry, I'm sending
the comforter, the teacher.
And that's the fire.
That's right.
That's the fire. But to get that kind of fire, he had to go through suffering.
Yes.
Now, many of us want to really get in the full-on power and fire, but not willing to suffer.
That touches deep.
You know, it touches me too. You know, if we really want to walk in the fire of the last day's army, if we really want to be participant of the amazing miracles that never ever before took place, as he promises, of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the creative miracles, we must then be prepared to follow him even through sufferings.
Take up your cross and follow me.
Yes.
No, it's very easy for us. We are having a cup of tea. We are enjoying the whole thing. We are talking about it. But you know what? When we go home, we have to realize that we'll be tested if we want. When we go to the streets, in a few years' time, who knows, persecution comes. It's still on. Christians have been persecuted. What are we going to do? Are we shying off? If we want to be in that power and that fire with the Lord, we must be willing. When we are willing, God makes us able.
Yes, yes.
Is that right?
Yes, it's right.
I believe that.
Yes, me too.
Yeah.
It's a biblical. If you're willing, he's there to provide us whatever we
need. To make us able. God will never ask us to do something he has not made grace for it. It is all about us. And I remember saying, Lord, you know what? I know this is many years ago. This is what you want me to do, but I'm not willing. At least, you know, he has given me the grace to realize I wasn't willing. I'm not willing. And then I'm thinking about it, but I'm willing to be made willing. So I'm bargaining with God because I have come by the power of the Holy Spirit to realize there's some areas in my life I'm not willing to let go. And surely many, many other believers are going through this very thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because this is our God.
Yes.
He's sweeter than the honeycomb. Amen. So we have come to the end of the subject of baptism. Water.
Holy Spirit,
fire,
and the baptism of suffering. All one baptism. So when we think of the commitment we day, the day we made, the day we baptized by water. Mm. Let's remember, it doesn't end there. Mm. There is more to it. And now that we are close to the end of this episode, I would like us to pray. Thank you, Holy Father, for your word. There is a man, a dark-colored man, who's sitting like on a chair, holding his head and crying, saying, "That's me, Lord. That's me, Lord." And even though that this is a program called Women on Fire that doesn't exclude men to be on fire, I believe that the Lord is saying to you, you're not a young man, you are in between. You're not an elderly man. You're a grown-up man. Believe the Lord is saying to you, my son, the Father made me able, and I will make you able. The glory that is beyond the obedience and the suffering is far greater than what you can imagine or have or receive from this world. If you want, give me your hand, your right hand now, and I will take you across. Thank you, Father. There's some young ladies, actually quite young, young teenagers, a few girls together watching this program and asking God to help you. And the Lord says He will. Just be faithful and be obedient. Thank you, Father. Loving Heavenly Father, we commit every word that you have given us by your Holy Spirit to be sealed in the hearts, all of our hearts, Lord, and everyone that has been listening with a desire to know you. Let every heart be fertile land, that out of the heart will spring forth righteousness and truth, passion and fire that will enable everyone to fulfill their destiny. And Father, we want to give you all the glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Precious beloved, please let us know your experiences with God. If this program has blessed you, let us know. And now, have a look at the end of your screen. There is an address there. Please write down and let us know. But for now, until we meet again, God bless you.